be talking on briefly about the anatomical imaging, that is the CT and the MR. My majority of the talk will be focusing on functional imaging, which includes Octoscan, Dotadate PET CT, and FDG PET CT. And then I will talk about, as we go through the cases, implications of the imaging results on the management. So just a brief one slide on neuroendocrine tumors. They originate from the neural crest cells. The incidence is slowly rising. And the most common sites are the gastroenteropancreatic tract and the lungs. Overexpression of the somatostatin receptors is the pathophysiology that is exploited in the functional imaging in the Octreotide scan and the gallium 68.8 PET. So briefly talking about the CT, it's often the initial imaging study and it's done with IV contrast, but even with IV contrast, the sensitivity of detecting a lesion is about 73%, but it's very good for anatomical details of the tumor. Here we can see a set of series of CT scan of a patient through axial slice through the liver. We're on the non-contrast study on the left side of the screen. We barely are able to see the tumor. As we image the patient through after giving the contrast, we start seeing some hypodensity in the liver, which is the metastasis. But as we image in the venous phase or the slightly delayed phase, imaging done at 75 seconds, the tumor is more evidently seen. So this imaging technique is very dependent on the contrast. Similarly for MR, it's best for detailing the hepatic metastasis and is good for detection of the primary pancreatic tumors. Here we can see an MR axial slice image, which shows multiple round hypodensities or areas of metastasis in the liver. So my main talk will be on the functional imaging, and the main indications are detection of the primary tumor, its staging, monitoring of the response to the therapeutic somatostatin, and treatment planning for SSTR-directed therapies. So what we do in functional imaging is give a tiny amount of radiation, tag it to the peptide, that is the octreotide or the octreotate, that is a somatostatin analog, and it basically binds or targets the somatostatin avid tumors in the patient's body. We can image it using SPECT CT, that is the old technology, but we can also use it scan using gallium 68.8 PET CT, that is the current gold standard. So Octreotide scan has been there since 1994. It was approved by FDA in 1994, and we were happy, very happy that we are able to see a lot of lesions. But when gallium 68.8 PET CT came, it proved that we were all wrong, and there were a lot of lesions that we were missing by on Octreotide. So this is how an Octreotide scan looks like. We have the anterior image and the posterior image. This is a negative scan. This is a normal biodistribution. We see uptake in the kidneys, spleen, liver, but I do not see any abnormal hotspot in the patient's body to call it a Octreotide avid tumor. Another patient is a 90-year-old lady who came with a incidentally diagnosed lung nodule in the left lung. The Octreotide scan shows a subtle uptake in the left upper lobe, and this was consistent with Octreotide avid carcinoid. Another case where there were a lot of hepatic lesions, those were Octreotide avid, but when the gallium 68.8 PET CT came, we all know that we missed a lot of lesions. So this is the comparison where Octoscan shows just one lesion, but gallium 68.8 PET shows a lot of lesions throughout the patient's body, in the bone, liver, nodes, everywhere. Similarly, these lesions were not even seen on the patient's CT, but gallium 68.8 PET shows a lot of these hotspots in the patient's liver. So this modality was approved in June 2016, and after that we have done a lot of gallium 68.8 scans at our institutions. What we do is combine the functional imaging with anatomical imaging, and this gives a good fusion images of the of both the anatomy and the functional imaging. So we have the PET imaging, that's the functional imaging, which shows us where the somatostatin receptor tumors are. We overlay those on the CT portion and then get a fusion imaging, which gets both stuffs. So who should have this scan? It's done for diagnosing neuroendocrine tumor, determine its treatment options, plan surgery, and monitor disease recurrence. Is there any preparation for this scan? Yes, the only requirement is that the patients taking long-acting somatostatin analogs should delay this test for 3 to 4 weeks after their last dose. So basically, whenever they are due for their next dose, they should have the scan just prior to receiving that therapy. Does it work better than the current testing modalities? Yes, it's a quicker scan. It takes about 2 hours as compared to the Octoscan, which usually takes about 2 to 3 days. It has better images. It's very highly sensitive. The images are very clear, crisp, high resolution. And it also helps in choosing the optimal therapy, such as surgery versus systemic therapy or PRRT. Does it have any clinical impact? Yes, in literature it has shown that it changed management in more than 50% of the cases. In our series at our institution, it showed that it changed management in more than 66% of the cases. So when is this gallium 68 DOTA-TACE scan done, or on which patients it is good? So we have, as was told previously, we have well-differentiated tumors and poorly differentiated tumors. Well-differentiated are usually called G1 or G2, grade 1 or grade 2 tumors, and poorly differentiated are the grade 3 tumors. So in grade 1 and grade 2, the gallium 68 DOTA-TATE PET or the Octreotide scan is very, very good. It works well. But for poorly differentiated tumor, only the FDG PET is positive. It will be gallium 68 DOTA-TATE will be negative in poorly differentiated tumors. So I will show you some examples. Here is a 25-year-old patient who was incidentally diagnosed with neuroendocrine tumor in an appendix specimen. He had a gallium 68 DOTA-TATE scan and nothing showed up, and the patient was just put on observation. Another patient where recently diagnosed metastatic neuroendocrine tumor. So gallium 68 DOTA-TATE scan showed a large area of uptake in the patient's liver, but there was another small focus of uptake just adjacent to the dominant lesion, which also required treatment or special attention on surgery or the radioembolization. Another case where patient had a lot of lesions, but these lesions, especially in the bones, were not even seen on the patient's CT scan. So it is very super sensitive as compared to the other imaging modalities. Here we can see lesion in the pelvic bone, in the sternum. These were not even seen on the CT. Another patient, so we can also follow up the patients on DOTA-TATE scan, on therapies using DOTA-TATE scan. So on the left side is the patient where she had a lot of lesions in the liver and the upper abdomen. In the subsequent scan done 8 months later, we see the hot spots in the liver have significantly decreased in intensity, which shows tumor response. Another patient where there were a lot of disease as seen on the CT, the liver is studded with metastatic lesions, but all these lesions are not lighting up on DOTA-TATE study. Only few of them are lighting up on the DOTA-TATE study. So initially, we were planning to give this patient PRRT therapy, but based on results of this scan, this patient was not an optimal candidate for receiving the DOTA-TATE therapy and received chemotherapy. Another patient with pancreatic neuroendocrine tumor, we had a very intense uptake in the pancreatic head region, and no other lesions were seen in the remaining part of the body. And this patient underwent surgery and was then placed on observation after that. Another patient where the patient had a lot of lesions, where the lesions are also noted in the bones, but there's not even a hint of it, of these lesions on the normal CT scan. So again, these scans are really sensitive and better than other imaging modalities. Another case of unknown primary tumor, had a lot of studies prior to it, CT, MR, all were negative except for the large metastatic lesions. But DOTA-TATE scan clearly showed a focal uptake in the patient's small bowel, And so this patient received resection of the small bowel tumor followed by Y90 therapies of the liver metastasis. Another lesion, patient had a lot of lesions, but there was lesion in the patient's left ventricle also in the heart, which required special attention and was not even seen on the other imaging modalities. Another case where there was a duodated avid lesion in the patient's mesenteric node. These lymph nodes were then resected surgically, and then patient was monitored later on. Another case where patient had a lot of metastatic lesions, had a rectal neuroendocrine tumor. 10 months later, we see after receiving the therapy, the intensity of these lesions have significantly decreased, and the liver metastasis have also significantly decreased. So this also is very helpful in monitoring the disease as the patient is receiving the treatment. Another case comparing MRI results to the duodated study, where the MR showed slight increase in the patient's hepatic metastasis, but as we see on the functional imaging, this image clearly shows that that lesion has been cured. There is no somatostatin avidity in these tumors. So we'll go through summary of these slides. So on the first one, we see there's no lesion, so patient was put on surveillance. On the second, the patient had a lot of lesions, received and was a good candidate for PRRT. This patient showed tumor heterogeneity, was initially planned for the PRRT therapy, but was deferred because of, but patient was not given PRRT therapy because of the tumor heterogeneity. This patient had isolated lesion in the pancreatic head, underwent surgery. Next patient showed, we were able to find the primary tumor in the small bowel that was resected, followed by Y90 treatment for the patient's liver metastasis. Another one, patient had mesenteric lymph nodes that were duodated positive and was surgically resected. So as we talked about the well-differentiated tumors, now talking about the poorly differentiated tumors or the G3 tumors, those will be FDG PET avid. They utilize glucose as their metabolic substrate and will not show somatostatin avidity on duodated scan. So these are the tumors which really should get FDG PET scan. So we talked about this. I will just show an example where the duodated scan is nearly negative, shows some lesions, but they're not really, really bright. But FDG PET shows a lot of osseous lesions which were not seen on the duodated. So this is a grade 3 or the poorly differentiated form of the tumor. So in summary, I can summarize in 3 points. Gallium 68 duodated PET is a new gold standard for staging of the G1 or G2 well-differentiated tumors. FDG PET CT is for G3 or poorly differentiated neuroendocrine tumors, and together these imaging modalities have a huge impact in the patient's management. Thank you.